Welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. My guest book is entitled 50 Mice. It's a novel, and all you can say is, Daniel Pine, why 50 Mice? The book is published by Blue Rider Press. Welcome.
Thank you.
Why 50 Mice?
It was a news article that I read years ago about some mice in Utah that genetically altered and behaved abnormally, and it really initially had nothing to do with the book. It had nothing to do with the story I wanted to tell, but it kept haunting me as a title, and I found a way to connect what I was doing to the title.
Well, the connection is that Jay, which is his name as we know him in the beginning, has a friend who he had worked for, who was at Vaughn, and he is a man who is using mice for genetic and for psychological testing.
Correct.
He leaves that job and he's doing something he really doesn't like, and he's got a girlfriend, and that night she goes off, he's drinking with the boys, and it's a club with a girl floating in a cocktail
glass? Mermaid stripper.
Is there such a thing?
I don't know. It sounded good, though, in a cocktail glass beaker.
And while he is there, a gun is shot. But he has already had some time with her the night before because he was much taken. And as he leaves, he is, in a sense, kidnapped.
Mm-hmm.
What is the basis of this?
I started with the basic notion of a man who gets taken into witness protection and doesn't know why. And I was initially fascinated by that, but I wasn't as interested in discovering what he knows as I was in examining how we remember things in the distant past. In this case, the incident at the bar happened a year ago, maybe, or 6 months ago. And I started thinking to myself, could I remember, if someone came to me and asked me what happened on March 18th of last year, would I be able to remember what happened on March 18th exactly? And that started to get me interested in memory, and I did a lot of research in it. And of course, there are a lot of experiments with mice and memory because mice, it turns out, are genetically similar to human beings.
I found that fascinating when I read here.
It gives whole new meaning to the term
of men and mice.
Men and mice, yeah. Don't act like a mouse, act like a man.
Now, I have to ask, the influence on you of writers such as Pirandello.
Mm-hmm.
Because I kept thinking, right you are, if you think you are, one of his plays.
Tim, Pynchon, Faulkner, I'm interested in thrillers as a motor, mm-hmm. as a driving force,
yeah.
but I'm also interested in the sort of issues of memory and character and reality and unreality that go along with those writers, with Pirandello, with Pynchon, with...
The play No Exit, because there is such a feeling of this guy is never, the only way out is death.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And Kafka. I mean, I was fascinated. Growing up, I was just fascinated reading Kafka's stories, reading his books. And that lovely intersect of circumstance and society, you know, it's the banality of evil. It's not a purposeful thing. In this case, the agents who take him are operating with the best intentions. Everyone involved in this at first is operating under the best intentions. They really believe that he's seen something they need to know. He truly believes he doesn't know what.
And he doesn't. Now he's trying to figure out, what did I see? I didn't see. And they take him and they have changed his name. Mm-hmm. They have, in essence, erased him. And as they are doing it, he's in a coma, or they put him in a coma.
He's unconscious, yeah.
And now he's put with the psychotherapist who is going to try to pull out this from his psyche.
Correct. And basically, they move him to Catalina. They put him in a safe house. They put him in a fake life with a woman and her child who are also in witness protection. And every day he goes to this office and he talks to a federal shrink. And the shrink says, what happened last year on this date? And Jay has no idea what they're looking for, so he can't make up a story. He tries to tell them the truth. And what actually happened to me in the course of writing the story was I realized it was less a story about what he saw and more a story about him looking back at his life and realizing how empty it was.
And why it was so empty.
And why it was empty.
Yeah.
And then at the same time, he starts to connect with this woman and her child. And he decides that the fake life they've given him is the one he wants.
Yeah.
And he has to figure out what to tell them in order to try to keep it.
They also have done a thing that most of us would find offensive, but you often hear about it here in Hollywood, of people changing your name. So although his name is Jay, they're now going to call him James.
Yeah, he doesn't like it.
Yeah.
And he doesn't like it for several reasons, but that relate to a past that he's been trying to bury.
Yeah.
So there are these layers of memory and these layers of recollection and these layers of secrets
in
the book.
And the little girl, Helen, will not talk to her mother, Ginger. Now, who's related to whom, we're never quite sure in the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
Helen finally talks to Jim, whatever.
To Jay.
Yeah, to Jay. And it's their secret.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, and that's the beginning of a relationship for a guy who never really related to children, never really had deep relationships with anyone for the longest time. And the relationship with this little girl kind of draws him out and changes him. It was a really, you know, it was so fun to construct and to write and to explore all these things because it became so much more than just a classic thriller.
How much investigation did you do with, like, the FBI and the people who are in charge of being witness protecting?
I had done, because of my other life as a screenwriter, I have intersected with that world and interviewed people in that world a lot, and I had a lot of background information. But I also, and I've read a lot, I like to read true crime novels, and I like to read stories about the FBI. But it was also a little bit in the wake of 9/11, the way that the Patriot Act kind of redefined how we could treat suspects and sort of the suspension of habeas corpus and the suspension of due process. I thought that I was in safe territory to suggest that for the most, you know, the best reasons, this organization could take him away and vanish him because they thought he knew something that was essential.
Yeah. But we never know what was essential till the end.
No.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah. And even they have a safe house next to his where he feels, well, he does begin to feel like Kafka. Everything's coming in on him.
And he discovers Catalina is such an isolated island off the coast of California. And it always struck me as a very bizarre, kind of romantic, kind of decrepit and romantic place, very much evoking both modern California and kind of that 40s noir California that we see in the movies. Yeah. And it struck me that it would be fascinating and frustrating for him if he couldn't determine who was in the program and who wasn't in the program on the island, because it's a very small permanent population. So when he tries to call out, they intercept his calls. When he tries to get on the internet, they control where he can go on the internet. When he meets his next door neighbors, they all pretend that they know him. They have a backstory with him that he doesn't actually have with them.
Yeah.
So there's this fiction that he's living, And he's trying to assert the reality of it, of his old life, but it's difficult. And the longer he stays there, the more difficult it becomes to find those
lines. And they've even set him up that he's running a video store, which most people don't even use anymore.
No, it's true. Yeah. It's true, because he doesn't have to earn any money. They're supporting him. So they need a job to sort of justify his being there, justify his days, but nothing that's important, no essential services provided.
All right. Describe for our friends public.
The two heads of this witness protection project call themselves John Public and Jane Doe. And Jay is never sure if that's their real names or not, but everyone in the piece has kind of a made-up name. Public is a very mercurial, very smart, very officious bureaucrat who appears the longer Jay gets to know him to be playing many sides of this equation and to perhaps know much more than he's letting on, even to his colleagues in witness protection.
And
Jane Doe is the yin to his yang. She's a kind of mysterious and earnest Fed who at first Jay doesn't think he can trust at all, and later learns that perhaps she's the one who will be able to help him more than Public.
Yeah. And she is the one who can shoot a gun.
Yes.
At one point in the beginning, you mentioned Seymour Hoffman.
Mm-hmm. In the acknowledgments.
Would he have played Public?
This started, this was a weird and wonderful process for me, because it started as a television idea that I couldn't get anyone interested in, just the notion of it. Then I wrote the story and decided it would make a great book. But as I started writing the book, I also decided while I'm breaking it down, I would turn it into a screenplay. So I wrote a screenplay with the intention of directing it, got it to Philip Seymour Hoffman, who I'd met on another movie project, and he fell in love with it. At first, he wanted to play Jay. Then he won the Academy Award.
Yeah.
And then he was going to play McGonis. And we got very close. McGonis is the psychiatrist who is asking Jay questions every day and is in his own right a kind of strange guy with a wandering eye and...
And a limp.
And a limp or
at
not.
Times.
Or not.
Yeah.
Depending. Yeah. And Philip was very interested in getting it made, and we came close a couple of times, and then he got particularly busy, and I got more involved. I decided I wanted to finish the book and pursue it that way.
It could also be a play.
It could, but for me, the extra visual texture, the setting, becomes very important. And it would be hard, I don't know, I'm not enough of a playwright or a dramaturge to know how you would evoke that Southern California feel. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of Los Angeles, a lot of Catalina in it.
And here he is trying to figure out, how do I get off this island? He has already tried once to escape.
With
and there is no escape.
Disastrous results, yeah.
Yeah, and there is no escape, no exit here.
Right.
Yeah.
He, for the longest time he wants to leave, and then at the moment when he kind of figures out how to leave, he realizes maybe he wants to stay, but this woman that he's becoming involved with, he wants to stay for Hannah, but she pushes him away.
Yeah. Why? Because it turs out she too is
a Fed.
Wherever he goes, he's like those mice.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, he's in a trap.
He's in a maze. Yeah, he's a mouse in a maze. And there's a lot of mouse maze metaphor going on. And as I got further into the project, I did a lot of research into the real science of mice.
In some ways, you've written two books.
You think?
Yeah, because once you get through, in a sense, you now know where everybody is. You know where he's going to maybe make an escape, even if it's different from what he finally does. And you begin to find out what his past was.
Right. That's true. And it was the very thing that made it challenging as a movie is that thing that makes it more of a book, makes it a novel, because I'm able to make this transition from what appears to be a very straightforward man against the system into this much dreamier investigation of who Jay is, what his past is, and how we're discovering that is influencing what his decisions are now, why he's holding things back.
The beginning part of it was once he sees his old girlfriend, who says, "Your mother called me and said you're in a hospital and you're insane, and I just figured, well, it's part of you, couldn't commit." And he said, "My mother never could have called you." That they have worked this whole thing out around him.
Mm-hmm.
And then Vaughn says the same thing to him.
They've created a backstory they create a new narrative for him that is perfectly plausible and supportable. And it's pretty common in witness protection. They create a new story for people so that they can live a new life.
But has anyone ever been through something like this in witness protection?
I have no idea.
Oh, okay.
I have no idea. Yeah. I hope not.
Yeah. Did you spend much time in Catalina?
I did. Not a lot, but I've spent time there both in season and out of season, and it's much different out of season.
Yeah.
And I preferred the out of season. It's very spooky out of season.
Well, in a way, it's not unlike, I don't know if you've ever been to Martha's Vineyard or Nantucket,
mm-hmm.
both in season and out of season, where you think, I'll never get off.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What's also kind of fascinating about Catalina is you have this small tourist town, and then the rest of the island, 90% of the island, is in conservancy. It's vacant. It's either, there are a couple of research facilities, there's a little tiny settlement at Twin Harbors, but the rest of the island is open. It has buffalo on it, it has lots of native plants that they're keeping in some kind of conservancy. It has old gold mining. It's a wild place. And it's a very California landscape. There aren't a lot of trees. It's very rugged. It's windswept.
And oddly enough, if you look at it from, say, Malibu or anything along the coast, it changes.
Mm-hmm.
Some days you don't see it at all, and other days it's right.
That's true. From my house in the hills, some days I see it and it looks like it's right next.
Yeah.
I mean, it's huge. The hills, the mountains are huge. And some days you can't even see it, or it's very flat on the horizon.
Yeah. Interesting place that changes. Now, he's there. The people who knew him have been given a phone number. If he shows up, call this number. And the way he shows up, they're going to call that number.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. He flees to Los Angeles to try to, he's not sure what, we're not sure what, but he flees to Los Angeles and discovers not only that he's been erased, but he confirms the fact that his connections to people were thin at best.
Is this your first book, Dan?
No, it's my third one.
You did something, 29 Palms?
29 Palms. I wrote about 29 Palms.
How long ago was that?
4 years ago.
Yeah. I think we did talk at that point.
We might have.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Nobody else has used that as a title that I'm aware of. Yeah.
Yeah. It was also very much set in a place and a time.
Yeah. And as anyone will know, 29 Palms is not Palm Springs. It's a different...
It's a very ramshackle little
dusty
town on the edge of a marine base in the Mojave Desert. And I hadn't spent any time there. I sort of fictionalized it completely.
Yeah.
But it seemed like a very quintessentially California desert town.
What films were you associated with prior to sitting to write the book?
When I started the book, I was doing The Sum of All Fears. When I was in the middle of it, I was doing Manchurian Candidate, the remake with Jonathan Demme. And as I was really deeply into the book, a movie called Fracture that I wrote got mm-hmm. made.
Manchurian Candidate is not so different. Dick Condon was also a fabulous writer. And he knew how to get that mystery and that threat mm-hmm. into his writing.
Yeah, he's another one of my favorite writers.
Yeah.
And the thing that he does so brilliantly is he found the paranoia in politics and in sort of the American psyche, and he went right at it.
Yeah.
The movie is equally interesting because they found a kind of dark humor in it. George Axelrod, the original writer, found this dark, dark humor in the sort of McCarthy era America. And then when we went back to redo it, we decided to take a much more less satirical, more political, paranoid, more like the original Condon novel.
End of the book here. What's going to happen? Is there a life after the 50 mice?
Yeah, I don't think there's another book, but Jay finds a kind of peace, and he grows a lot in the course of it. He manages to get what he wants. Somehow he stumbles through it all and gets what he wants. I love stories about ordinary people in extraordinary situations where they have to rise to the occasion. And he is an ordinary man who is forced to deal with some really scary and crazy circumstances. And he gets through it.
Yeah. But I happen to love that you have interesting people, whether it is the school teacher who's writing what? A German version.
She's writing the Pied Piper as a musical.
Yes.
In the style of Sondheim.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, also a little
and
bit.
And Little Rodgers and Hammerstein. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, and here is our little Helen who's making clouds.
Mm-hmm.
She's the cloud maker.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I love it. One of the things that I love about screenwriting is the ability to write these odd passing through characters. And one of the joys of novel writing is you can expand them. They suddenly come to life. They're not just a bit player in a scene.
Well, that's the thing, that no one here is just walking through.
No.
Whether it's Sandy next door and Barry and all of the characters, they're three-dimensional.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah, specificity is very important to me. Specificity of people and place and the quirky things that we all recognize in our environment, in the people around us.
How do you plot?
How do I plot? I start with a notion and a character.
Yeah.
And I try to let the character go.
Yeah.
And I confront him or her with a problem. And then I try to stay with that character to see how they'll solve it. And each decision that they make leads to something else, and the plot builds in that way.
Yeah.
And I go beginning to end. I don't jump around. I try to just figure it out. But I try to figure it out before I start writing.
Yeah.
I do.
I will say one thing. He may have been the hero, but he too had a bullet that went through him, and they'll have to read how and why. Thank you so much,
Daniel. Thanks for having me.
My pleasure. Will you autograph my book?
Sure.
And if you'd like to know what we've been reading, follow me on YouTube where the show will be on in another couple of weeks, or Claremont Graduate University Digital Library, because film or videotape, after a certain point, will disintegrate. So it is really essential to keep something, having it digitized. But take your children, go yourself, support your library. It's a most vital, really, institution in America. And whatever you can do, donate to it, give your time, and we'll see you next time. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dan.
Thanks for having me.